Greetings and welcome. We are in senior AP English, and our objective now is to work with the work with the poetry of Percy Bysshe Shelley. I've already said a few things about Shelley, but I want to now kind of bring this this conversation full circle. Shelley, in many ways, is one of the most radical writers of the English poetic tradition. He certainly is going to hold private opinions that are going to be controversial. And then he also lives a pretty publicly controversial life as well. He not only claims atheism as his theology of choice, but he also will live openly with Mary Shelley, the author of Frankenstein. With two wives, if you will. He has a somewhat tragic end. He goes for a little rowboat excursion out onto the lake, and he ends up drowning. Interestingly, for your notes, and this is a bit of trivia that we'll make more of next week, when Shelley is found washed up on the beach, in his coat pocket is a collection of the poetry of Keats, which is interesting. It tells us that Shelley had already identified the work of Keats as worthy of admiration. And that says a lot, because Shelley didn't admire very many contemporary poets. He himself thought he was probably better than all of them. Let's point out right away that the romantic poets, like Wordsworth and others, want to work within classical traditions, but they want to play games within those traditions and forms that are going to be, for lack of a better phrase, romantic. Let me give you a classic example. I'm with you on 848. This is the famous sonnet, so there is the form, Ozymandias. All right, so let's take a look at this poem now together. Ozymandias on page 848. Shelley will write, "I met a traveler from an antique land who said, 'Two vast and trunkless legs of stone stand in the desert. Near them on the sand, half sunk, a shattered visage lies, whose frown and wrinkled lip and sneer of cold command tell that its sculptor well those passions read, which yet survive, stamped on these lifeless things, the hand that mocked them and the heart that fed.'" And on the pedestal, these words appear: "My name is Ozymandias, King of Kings. Look on my works, ye mighty, and despair." Nothing beside remains. Round the decay of that colossal wreck, boundless and bare, the lone and level sands stretch far away. Now, let's begin by asking a couple of quick observations about the setup of the poem. You have the speaker, we'll go ahead and call him Shelley, who is reporting a story that was told to him by a fellow traveler. Jot down in your notes, where did this traveler go? He is reporting information from what part of the world? So that's kind of important for us to start with. He was down in Egypt. While he was down in Egypt, he says, "I found this interesting sight," and then he starts to tell about it. What was this sight? Well, down there in the middle of the desert, he found two vast and trunkless legs of stone standing in the desert. So he's got these two legs that just come out of the sand, out of the desert. Near them, on the sand, half sunk, a shattered visage lies. What is a visage? If I'm driving my truck and I don't want the sun in my face, I drop my visor. This is the word, of course, that etymologically comes from the same root. A visage is your face, right? So in other words, on the sand lying there, half sunk, is the face that has been sculptured. He says about the face, "whose frown and wrinkled lip and sneer of cold command tell that its sculptor well those passions read, which yet survived, stamped on these lifeless things." What does that mean? Put it in your own words. What's he say about the visage, the face of this sculpted statue? How would you qualify it? What adjectives would you give to it? What does the sneer of cold command mean? Wait, if Kelleher sneers at Ramos, what does he do?
Oh.
Miss Ramos, you can get him back later.
Okay.
Okay. There is ice in her water bottle. Sneer by a ruler would mean what? Yes, this feeling of superiority. Notice he finishes by saying, the hand that mocked them, the heart that fed. The image, we're told, the sculptor knew well the one he was sculpting. Who was he sculpting? The title, obviously, is our giveaway here, right? Ozymandias, one of the greatest of all pharaohs, right? Now, this will raise a really intriguing question for us, and Shelley wants us to go there, and that is, of course, the question of what constitutes a great leader. Here we can come full circle again. You'll notice that as we end our time together, we begin to finish some of these circles, where, for example, at the beginning of our senior year, we began with this question, what constitutes a great leader? And you will maybe remember from Plato's Republic that we were given, ostensibly, a tripartite answer. A great leader possesses three great traits. Ethos, pathos, logos. Now, of course, we're working in Greek language now, so we'll translate. Ethos, moral character, moral authenticity. In other words, Plato will argue that a leader can lead if the people believe that that leader is morally authentic, acceptable, right? In other words, tells the truth, doesn't do mean things to people for unjust reasons, etc., etc. Well, what is this thing about pathos? Plato says, well, this is the whole likability issue for leaders. The people have to somehow feel emotionally connected to the leader, that he has their best interests at heart. He's a nice guy, or in the case of Plato, a nice gal, you'll remember, right? Right. And then finally, three, logos. Well, this is all about Plato, isn't it? And of course, Aristotle will totally agree on this count. That is to say, intellectual, rational, logical. In other words, his or her actions are committed from a source of reason. So that the people then, and this is crucial for Plato, have the capacity to predict behavior. Some of you have grown up with parents, for example, who are inconsistent in regards to logos. So for example, one time you will go and say, I want to go out on a Friday night. Oh, sure, no problems. The next time, same exact request, and now all of a sudden an entire, you know, world blows up and you have this huge fight and there's absolutely no, you ask the question, I don't understand, like give me some logic as to why. There is no logic, there's only I make the rules, you obey the rules. Some of us have friends like this. Some days, very kind of normal keel. Other days, all over the map, you know, throw fits, etc., etc. You can never predict that individual's behavior patterns. Plato said, those kinds of people don't make good leaders. Predictability is huge if you want to be a good leader, because then the people will grow accustomed to the expectations of the leader. That's Plato's view of what makes a good leader. But let's point out for your notes, because you know this already, that in the history of thought, that isn't the only view. And in fact, there's going to be an antithetical view to the Platonist view, and it's best represented by what great writer? Machiavelli, in his classic text, The Right. And in The Prince, Machiavelli will say, oh, so wrong. Study history. It's got absolutely nothing to do with ethos, pathos, and logos. What a load of crapos, Machiavelli will say. You want to talk about what make great leaders? It's really, really simple. Great leaders are all about power, maintaining power. Now, we'll, of course, call this the Thrasymachean view from Republic, remember. But it's real simple for Machiavelli. The greatest leaders are the ones who gain power and hold power, not through love, remember, but through, it's real simple, it's fear. If you're going to be a good parent, it's really simple. You tell your kid, come home at midnight. If you're not home at midnight, if you're home at 12:01, all your crap's sitting out in the front lawn. By tomorrow morning at 7, it's going to the thrift store if you don't find a place to get it. You go live somewhere else. That's my rule. Now, if you genuinely believe, think of it this way, if you genuinely believe that that parent is not BSing but is authentic and real, chances are, if you want a place to sleep, chances are you're going to be home a few minutes before midnight. Why? Because you're not interested in testing to see whether, in fact, that individual is kind of, you know, having fun, messing around, playing head games, or is straight up true. Machiavelli says it's very simple to parent, just like it's very simple to lead. All you got to do is just jack them. Jack them good right at the beginning so they know you're for reals. Of course, if you want to dissent under Machiavelli's view of leadership, that's fine. That's why God made bullets, right? Yeah, you don't have to agree with my position, Machiavelli says as leader. I'll just put a bullet in your head. And it's a funny thing about putting bullets in people's heads. Everybody else lines up right behind the leader after that one. Of course, Machiavelli was smart enough to say strategic violence is a whole lot better. In other words, it's more like this. Appear to be Platonist. Appear to possess pathos, ethos, logos. But the truth of the matter is you're really a fox. That is to say, you do whatever you got to do to get what you want. The ends justify the means. Might makes right. Now, in the history of the world, it is, of course, a fascinating study to look at the greatest leaders and ask the simple question. Were they more Platonist in their approach to leadership, or were they more Machiavellian in approach to their leadership? A fascinating study. It could be a year study of its own. Would be to take a look at every one of the American presidents, study their biographies, and then ask the simple question about all those men. And to this point, they've only been men. At some point in the future, there will probably be a woman. Then would be in Plato's pantheon, right? He would argue that a woman can have ethos, pathos, and logos, right? If well-educated, remember? Plato's all about education. But to ask about each one of those leaders of the American presidency, were they more Platonist or were they more Machiavellian? See, it's always interesting to hear people lambast sitting leaders, whether they be presidents or whatever. The next time somebody, for example, gets off on one of these kicks about the current president or whatever, after you've had enough listening to the tirade, simply pause and say, okay, I get it. You clearly do not like the leader that now is the president of the United States. I got that. I understand that. My question to you is this one, though. What is a good leader? And don't give me an individual. Give me a philosophic instantiation, characteristics. What makes a great leader? I'm interested in that. And then actually pin them down. That's the question of Ozymandias. What constitutes great leadership? Now we're back to Plato again. Ozymandias, we are going to be told, had a certain view of himself. He has this cat sculpture him, and then he sticks that sculpture in the desert. The face tells us everything. Sneer of cold command. Notice, he will say, our translator of this information will say, the hand that mocked them, the heart that fed, mocked them. Machiavellian or Platonist? Was Ozymandias a Machiavellian or was he a Platonist? Clearly Machiavellian, right? In other words, it's very simple. You frighten people into doing what it is that you want them to do. It's much better to be feared than it is to be loved. Why? Because people who love you can be fickle. They'll also take advantage of you if they love you. But if they fear you, that's a different ball game. They will not cross the line because they are afraid. Simple, Machiavelli says. But we're not done. Because now we're going to meet Shelley's irony, and let's call it that for our notes. Shelley is, in many ways, he's really good at poetic irony, and he plays a nicely poetic game here with us. And in the process, he identifies himself as a romantic. Let's take a look at what happens next in the poem. On the pedestal, what's a pedestal? It's at the base, right? It's at the base. You got some words, don't you? What are these words? My name is Ozymandias, King of Kings. Look on my works, ye mighty, and despair. Now this is interesting. Who are the words specifically for on the pedestal? What do you think, Schreiber? King of Kings, look on my works, ye mighty, and despair. Is Ozymandias commenting to his own people? No. He's not. He doesn't even care about his own people. Who has he put these words on the pedestal for when he says, I am the greatest king of all time? I'm number one. I'm number one. Who's he saying? He's saying this for all the other kings. What does he say to them? Look on my works, ye mighty, and despair means what? What would you say, Miss Kennedy?
You should be afraid of me?
Yeah, you might as well fear me. Why fear him? Look on what? His works. Now, what would that mean? We clearly don't mean a sculpture. Right. What accomplishments? What is it that Ozymandias has done? This sculpture will be placed in front of a city that he created in the middle of the desert. Amazing city with all kinds of buildings. Huge city. Notice the irony. Round, nothing, we're told, nothing beside remains. What's happened to all of Ozymandias' works?
Gone.
What do you mean gone? How could they be gone? Eroded, Mr. Batson says. Eroded by what? Time, sand, wind. Or in a word, nature. Right? Nothing beside remains. Look what is said about the whole environment. Round the decay of that colossal wreck. What's been wrecked? Poor Ozymandias. All of his mighty works gone. Boundless and bare, the lone and level sands stretch far away. Okay, let's work level 2A real quickly. Please, what is it that Shelley, do you think, is actually saying in this poem? I mean, clearly we could talk about leadership, and we could talk about good old Ozymandias.
Doesn't matter what or who you are, nature is always going to
help. Let's put it in mathematical equation with the greater lesser sign. On what side are you going to put the greater then if you're working with Ozymandias?
Nature.
You're obviously going to put the forces of nature there. It does not matter how big a city you build. It does not matter in the confines of this poem. It does not matter how great or magnificent a leader you are. What is it Marcus Aurelius says in Meditations? Another 3A observation for you. Soon you will have forgotten all things, and all things will have forgotten you. Okay? Why write a poem like this? Now let's finish by asking, what makes this a romantic offering? And can you give me any references at 3A to other romantic texts that play the same game? Why Child Harold's Pilgrimage? It's interesting because Shelley and Byron are best pals, okay? They hang out a lot together. And Shelley loved Child Harold's Pilgrimage. He loved it. Shelley respected Byron and Keats. It's kind of like two of the two contemporaries. Same argument was made there, huh? No matter how great humanity becomes, it always seems that nature wins out. One thing we can quasi-predict with some assurance is that in 1,000 years, you won't be here, but probably Cloud Peak will. Now, again, we can't be definitive, right? I mean, there's always the potentiality that something insane happens, but we kind of have a feeling that mountain's going to outlast anything we construct here. Therein lies the romantic argument, right? And now we're back, of course, to this whole idea that Wordsworth was playing with, the sea that bears her bosom to the moons, blah, 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 right? For this, for everything, we're out of tune. Speaking of tune, let's go to Shelley's greatest offering. If we have time, we'll at least get through a first step in this one, all right? Ode to the West Wind. And I want to begin now at 2B with you by defining, because you're going to see this on your exam, by defining this word ode. Now, earlier we had that word what? From Byron? Apostrophe to the ocean. And remember, what do we say an apostrophe was? Yeah, you're basically writing the poem as if you're speaking to an inanimate object. Let's just say it easily for ourselves with some sophomoric language. Ode equals apostrophe. Apostrophe equals ode. Okay? They are fundamentally very similar in that you again are going to be writing words speaking directly to some kind of object that is non-human, pretending as if it has the capacity to understand what you're saying. In this case, it is the wind. All right? And since we're reading this in the spring, when wind can come up out of nowhere, as can, of course, weather, it makes some sense to maybe take a look at this poem from that perspective. The first thing I want to say has to do with 2B regarding form, and I'm going to help you take annotation notes over this one. A number of questions from this one will end up on the exam, which is why we're going to read it a little bit slower and pay more attention. Please note, there are five sections or parts to this poem. Do you see it? So what I would recommend that you do real quickly is jot down in your notes Roman numerals 1 through 5. However, I would skip a few lines in between, and here's why. In each one of these parts, Shelley, or the speaker of the poem, we'll call him Shelley, will do two things. One, he will speak about the wind and a special attribute of the wind, okay? The wind does something. Two, he makes a request to the wind in each one of these five parts, all right? Now, the truth is, if you know those two things for each one of those five parts, that is to say, if you know those 10 pieces of information, you will know this poem very well. Likewise, let's point out stylistically in terms of form that each one of the parts is divided up into stanzas of three lines until you get to the last stanza of each part, which then becomes a couplet. Do you see that? So Shelley is going to play intentional games with form as he plays this game of romantic observations. And this is a purely romantic work. I mean, it will fall right in line with Tintern Abbey and some other poems that we've studied that we've qualified as romantic. Let's now do a reading of the poem so we can at least hear it for the first time. Ode to the West Wind. O wild West Wind, thou breath of autumn's being, thou from whose unseen presence the leaves dead are driven like ghosts from an enchanter fleeing. Yellow and black and pale and hectic red, pestilence-stricken multitudes. O thou who cheritest to their dark wintry bed the winged seeds where they lie cold and low, each like a corpse within its grave, until thine azure sister of the spring shall blow her clarion o'er the dreaming earth and fill driving sweet buds like flocks to feed in air with living hues and odors plain and hill. Wild spirit, which art moving everywhere, destroyer and preserver, hear, O hear. Thou on whose stream, mid the steep sky's commotion, loose clouds like earth's decaying leaves are shed, shook from the tangled bough of heaven and ocean, angels of rain and lightning, there are spread on the blue surface of thine airy surge, like the bright hair uplifted of the head of some fierce maenad, even from the dim verge of the horizon to the zenith's height, the locks of the approaching storm. Thou dirge of the dying year, to which this closing night will be the dome of a vast sepulchre vaulted with all thy congregated might of vapors, from whose solid atmosphere black rain and fire and hail burst. Oh, hear. Thou who didst waken from his summer dreams, the blue Mediterranean where he lay, lulled by the coil of his crystalline streams, beside a pumice isle in Baiae's Bay, and saw in sleep old palaces and towers quivering within the waves' intenser day, all overgrown with azure moss and flowers so sweet, the sense faints picturing them. Thou for whose path the Atlantic's level powers cleave themselves into chasms, while far below the sea blooms and the oozy woods which wear the sapless foliage of the ocean know thy voice and suddenly grow gray with fear and tremble and despoil themselves. Oh, hear. If I were a dead leaf thou mightst spare, if I were a swift cloud to fly with thee, a wave to pant beneath thy power and share the impulse of thy strength, only less free than thou, O uncontrollable. If even I were as in my boyhood, and could be the comrade of thy wanderings over heaven, as then, when to outstrip thy sky, speed scarce seemed a vision, I would ne'er have striven as thus with thee in prayer in my sore need. O lift me as a wave, a leaf, a cloud. I fall upon the thorns of life, I bleed. A heavy weight of hours has chained and bowed one too like thee, tameless and swift and proud. Make me thy lyre, even as the forest is. What if my leaves are falling like its own? The tumult of thy mighty harmonies will take from both a deep, autumnal tone, sweet though in sadness. Be thou spirit fierce, my spirit. Be thou me impetuous one. Drive my dead thoughts over the universe like withered leaves to quicken a new birth. And by the incantation of this verse, scatter as from an unextinguished hearth ashes and sparks, my words among mankind. Be through my lips to unawakened earth the trumpet of a prophecy. O wind, if winter comes, can spring be far behind? Now, there are any number of ways to address, as I say, Shelley's greatest work. But the place I'm going to go is with you on page 857. Our focus tomorrow will be in large measure to exegete more clearly this text. However, before we get there, I want you to get there. In other words, I mean, in answer to Mr. Keller's really important question about what's up with these poetry offerings, one of the answers that I often will give is the following, and having done this now a year or two, I'm able to validate over time. I often say it this way: if you can read and understand, for lack of a better phrase, crap like Ode to the West Wind, there isn't much that they're going to give you at the university to read that you won't be able to figure out. I really mean that. I mean, if you can actually figure out what Ode to the West Wind is saying, you're probably not going to struggle so much reading physics or calculus or biology or history, because this kind of stuff is more esoteric than most of that other garbage that you're going to have to get. So I'm going to suggest to you that you're going to spend some time on your own looking at Ode to the West Wind. However, I'm going to give you a focus. Obviously, I've already suggested to you the way that you should annotate, looking for those 10 pieces of information. But I'm going to take you one step further, and I'm with you now on page 857. Shelley was having a conversation with a pal. Shelley, like Keats, believed that the greatest calling in the world was to be a poet. So, for example, if asked, what will you major in college? His immediate answer would be, the only thing one could major in. Poetry, of course. To be a poet is the only calling. Everything else is secondary. This was Shelley's view. And a pal of his started laughing at him and said, poetry? Dude, poetry is dead and nobody cares anymore. We now have science. We're not interested in poetry anymore. I don't believe in poetry. I believe in science. This led Shelley to sit down and to write what will later be called a defense of poetry. This is Shelley's apology for poetry. Remember, we use that word apology to mean defense, right? Your textbook will give you just a few lines, and this is what I want you to do. I want you to look at what Shelley says great poetry does. And then I'm going to ask you tomorrow the simple question, does his Ode to the West Wind do this very thing? In other words, Shelley said, if you're going to write a great poem, if you're going to be a poet, this is what it is that you do. Does it work? I mean, does he actually accomplish his goal? Take a look at it. Poetry, you should be reading with me now on 857. Poetry is indeed something divine. It's at once the center and circumference of knowledge. Poetry is not like reasoning, a power to be exerted according to the determination of will. A man cannot say, I will compose poetry. Sorry for all of our young authors, writers for poetry. The greatest poet cannot even say it. For the mind in creation is as a fading coal, with some invisible influence, like an inconstant wind, awakens to transitory brightness. This power arises from within, like the color of a flower, which fades and changes as it is developed. And the conscious portions of our nature are unprophetic, either of its approach or its departure. Poetry turns all things to loveliness. It exalts the beauty of which that which is most beautiful, and it adds beauty to that which is most deformed. It marries exaltation and horror, grief and pleasure, eternity and change. It subdues to union under its light yoke all irreconcilable things. It transmutes all that it touches, and every form moving within the radiance of its presence is changed by wondrous sympathy of an incantation of the spirit which it breathes. Its secret alchemy turns to potable gold the poisonous waters which flow from death through life. It strips the veil of familiarity from the world and lays bare the naked and sleeping beauty which is the spirit of its forms. Now, this is a really interesting passage, and it's one that we've got to debate at some point. I love to speak with artists. I'll ask them any number of questions. First, the canvas had nothing on it. Then you started. How did you know where to start? And with what color? Did you, for example, already know that it was going to look like that? I love to ask questions like this. Shelley will say, artists, poets, and we'll have this debate as we get closer to Joyce and his portrait of the artist as a young man, a classic novel. The question Shelley will ask is, where does the inspiration come from for the artist? So that the artist will often report to me, well, first it was just canvas. Then I started to do something on the canvas. Yeah, I know that. But I'm interested in knowing what made you start where and with what color. Like, why did you have it in your mind's eye? Often artists will report, I don't know the answer to that. I cannot answer that. It's called inspiration. I don't know. But Shelley says something interesting. You can't sit down and make a picture. You can't just write a poem. True artists have a gift. But that gift can go away. A fading coal is his word picture. That troubles artists who are aware they have it for a while, maybe, but they might not have it someday in the future. That will haunt artists who have some capacity, not unlike athletes who have some abilities. They're aware the physical body's going to decay. You cannot remain at optimum physical conditioning all your life. The same is true for Shelley about artists and the imagination. In other words, it's an interesting question. Will you begin to grow duller creatively as you age? Does the coal start to fade? And right now you maybe have some kind of intellectual energy, but will you still have it in 10 years? Shelley says most likely no. Which is why if we have poets among us, artists, they're so invaluable. That's why they're the most important people in a civilization, because they're very special people. Shelley was playing in the tradition of the Greeks. As remember, they saw their gods, they saw humans as being distinctly different. Poets, artists, are those individuals in the middle. They're the most important individuals because they give us the songs. The meanings of life come from the songs, to speak in Greek terms. So take a look at Defensive Poetry and ask, in Ode to the West Wind, once you figure out what he's saying, does he do what he says great poets do? All right, and we'll come back tomorrow and ask, does he?